Hey there, Wonder Warriors. Welcome to my home on the farm. This is Diesel.
Here's Boots.
And this guy is Crisco. Needless to say, I'm a bit of an animal person. I find that when I'm feeling down or stressed out, interacting with animals can be a surefire way to feel better. I'm curious though, how much of this pet therapy is actually a real thing, or is it all in my head? Can animals actually experience emotions the same way humans do? Or are we anthropomorphizing a little bit? Ultimately, what's the science behind pet therapy? It's pretty obvious that we form strong emotional connections with animals, but why? I was surprised to learn that animal-assisted therapy is an actual practice.
We stick our claws in his, like, feathers on his neck and head, and just scratch and tickle. And then he gets all fluffed up, just like that.
A good friend of mine founded a business that specializes in this, so I decided to get his opinion on the subject.
Oh, wow.
What got you into it? This exotic animal therapy stuff.
Me and a friend of mine had our own pet parrots, yeah. And when you have pet parrots, it's drilled into how much social attention they need. In order to get them that attention, we would volunteer at a local nursing home. But this turned out to be so popular with the residents, it turned out to be a beneficial two-way relationship, basically, and long story short, we now run Canada's largest pet therapy program.
But what exactly is pet therapy?
It's very simply positive interactions between people and animals.
The other way he likes to be held is like a baby, just like that.
Something that everyone has in common is they love animals. And because animals are living creatures, many of which are social animals, which have similar emotions and similar social structures to us, we can elicit the same kind of positive responses between an animal and a human that we do in a positive interaction between two humans.
Does the science say anything about what's going on when you actually are interacting with the animals?
All of the same neurotransmitters, all of the same circuitry in our brain that goes on when we're interacting with people, very, very similar when we're interacting with animals.
It turns out we have specialized brain cells for recognizing animal life. And get this, some Boston-based researchers identified similar brain activity when mothers viewed images of their children or their dogs.
There's all sorts of studies about if you touch someone, just the benefit of touching them, having physical contact, the exact same effects you have when you're patting an animal. And we're both getting positive emotional benefits and hormonal benefits and social benefits from that interaction.
There's lots of evidence that animals do help with stress relief. In one particular study, people were more likely to survive for a year after having a heart attack if they had a pet. Now, call me skeptical, but don't our animal friends have to understand us to provide real therapy?
Do you really think animals feel the same kinds of emotions we feel, or are we anthropomorphizing a bit?
People are very much in the habit of anthropomorphizing. They do it a lot. People will have a snake on their lap, thinking that it understands them, it recognizes them, it loves them. It doesn't understand a thing you're saying.
Right.
It can't even hear you, in fact. But a highly social animal, like a dog or a parrot, gets a lot out of the social interaction. They have a lot of the same social circuitry in their brain. They have a lot of the same rules of reciprocity. They have a lot of the same emotions that we do.
Evolutionary biologists believe that years of domestication help to shape their communication and learning skills. In other words, natural selection would favor genes that make the dogs more efficient at regulating their aggression, learning and following rules, and forming attachments, which is the essence of social competence, according to psychologists. Now, what about cats?
When I was playing with Aspen, I'm pretty sure we actually did develop a true connection.
Well, you were an especially good cat toy for the lynx Aspen because you're especially smelly. You were very low to the ground, so it was very easy for her to practice pouncing on your neck and batting your hair. Whether you're with a house cat or a lion, they will treat you exactly the same way. Cats are all assassins in teddy bear outfits. It sounds slightly cynical, but a lot of evolutionary biologists see the phenomenon of pet animals as animals tricking us into thinking that they're cute and to doing things for them, like shelter, which protects them from all the predation, like free food, which they no longer have to hunt for. We give a ton to the animals and they're basically conning us.
They're manipulating us.
They are emotionally manipulating us, but in a positive way.
At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter whether the empathy we prescribe onto them is real.
Not for the sake of the pet therapy.
Yeah, you still feel good in the end.
Anthrozoologists say we've been getting pets for years to help fill our need for social connectedness. For me, playing and exercising my hyperactive dog and cleaning the stalls for the horses has therapeutic value.
Coming, Boots.
Since our pets depend almost entirely on us to fulfill their needs, maybe they help fill our need to nurture other living beings. But I want to hear from you. I'm curious if any of you animal lovers out there are willing to share your stories of how your pet might have helped you overcome depression or anxiety. If you're willing to share your story, post in the comment section below or ask any questions you might have about the topic. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button to get regular updates on when more awesome content about the science of mental health comes out. See you next time, Wonder Warriors!